What's the first thing that springs to mind when I say, what is the system which keeps London ticking? You might say the tube or pubs, but how far down the list would you have said the sewers of London? It's a system which has a rather whiffy but riveting past, and London would not be the powerhouse without it. This is a stinky but fascinating history of the sewers in London. Prior to the mid-19th century, London's attitude towards sanitation can only be described as a rather laissez-faire approach. The main way to get rid of sewage would be either to store it in hundreds of cesspits around the city, where an unlucky fella would have the job of cleaning them out and the potential of them blowing up in their face. Or if you were really lazy, you would just dump it straight into the River Thames, which lo and behold was one of the most popular methods. The introduction of the flushing toilet would only exacerbate the problem of sewage being dumped into the Thames. However, as one can imagine, this method of dealing with wastewater was clearly unsustainable, and things would come to light in June of 1858 in what was to be known as the Great Stink. The months of June and August were particularly hot, which meant there was a very, very strong whiff of sewage in the air coming from the River Thames, which made its way to Westminster and into the noses of politicians in the newly built Houses of Parliament. Attempts were made by Parliament to try and mask the smell, but it was to no avail. Parliament could no longer sit there idle and actually had to do something. The Great Stink was the catalyst for Parliament to clean up the Thames, and they called on civil engineer who went by the name of Joseph Bazalgette and his amazing moustache to help them design a proper sewer system. Bazalgette's design was to construct a network of 82 miles of intercepting sewers, which would collect wastewater from existing sewers, moving it eastwards and further downstream of the River Thames, where it could be discharged with the outgoing tide. The network would cater for areas north and south of the river, with the northern sewers outfalling at Beckton Works and the southern sewers outfalling at Crossness, with both treatment works still in operation to the present day. The system would mostly fall by gravity, but in areas where this wasn't possible, pumping stations were built to ensure the sewage could be moved to a higher level. For the northern sewer, a pumping station was built at Abbey Mills, and in the south, it was at Deptford. You might have thought that because these were pumping stations for sewage works, they would be bland and nothing special, but you would have thought wrong. Both pumping stations had no expense spared, creating architecturally stunning buildings, which are definitely hidden gems of London. To assist the sewers in moving water eastwards and catch waste flowing downhill towards the Thames, new embankments would be constructed along the banks of the Thames at Chelsea and Victoria, which would also house the District Line Railway alongside the sewers. Whilst designing the sewers, Bazalgette had the foresight to account for London's future growth in population, dismissing initial proposals for narrow pipes, for which he said, "Well, we're only going to do this once, and there's always the unforeseen." Bazalgette instead doubled the diameters of the sewers, and this decision has allowed for the sewers to accommodate for demand even up to the present day. The sewers themselves would take the shape of an egg. There were a few ingenious reasons to why this particular design was adopted. As you may be aware from trying to stand on an egg, they are very good at transferring compressive loads, making them incredibly strong, which was important as they had to withstand the weight of development above. The second reason was the top of the egg, or the bottom in this case, closely resembled a V-shaped channel, allowing for higher velocities in low flow rates, reducing the chance of sediment buildup at the bottom of the sewer compared to a circular pipe, lessening the amount of maintenance that would be required. Work on the sewers was finally completed in 1875 and would carry over 2 billion litres of waste every day. This essential piece of infrastructure would allow for London's population to continue to grow throughout the centuries to over 8 million in the present day. However, as ingenious as Bazalgette's design was, as London's population expanded, the pressure on the sewer systems have started to come to light. One of the issues has been the reliance on combined sewer overflows, or CSOs. These are essentially bits of the sewer network which allow sewage to be rerouted and discharged directly into the Thames during storm events when too much rain enters the system for the network to fully handle. As one can imagine, during these times of increased environmental awareness, discharging poo into the Thames is something that would not go down well with the residents of London in the 21st century. To help solve this issue, London is in the process of constructing a new super sewer, which is to be called Thames Tideway Tunnels. And these tunnels are not just big, but really, really big. The main tunnel is to have a diameter of 7.2 metres, which for comparison is double the size of a standard tube tunnel. The tunnel is to run from Acton in the west through central London and out to Abbey Mills in the east of the city before being pumped to the water treatment plant at Beckton. These tunnels will not just be massive but deep as well, starting at 30 metres below ground at Acton and will finish at 70 metres below ground at Abbey Mills. The tunnels are expected to cost a cool £4.2 billion and should be completed by 2024. When finished, the tunnels should be able to carry 1.6 million cubic metres of sewage, which is the same as nearly 700 Olympic-sized swimming pools, bringing London's sewer network into the 21st century. And that just about ends this whistle-stop journey through the evolution of London sewers, a system which certainly holds no glitz or glamour, but without it, the city streets are more likely to be paved in poo than they would be with gold. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, a tap of the like and subscribe button would be amazing. I have plenty of more topics which I'm just itching to talk about, and your support would be hugely appreciated. What was the thing which most surprised you about London sewers? Leave a comment down below. I'd love to know your thoughts. This has been A Civil Conversation, and I will see you in the next video.